Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for each person here listening. And pray, Lord, that you would send your Holy Spirit to teach us and guide us. We thank you for giving us your word. We pray now that you use Pastor Izzy to teach us and to encourage us, to show us things that would encourage our walk with you. And we ask that now in Jesus' name. Everyone agreed said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, if you would turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 1. We covered all of two verses, verse 16 and 17, last week in depth. As we look to the book of Habakkuk, which was the book that Paul the Apostle quoted from as he quoted this verse. So I'm going to pick up with what he quoted, because if you ever study the writings of Paul, you're going to learn Paul is a guy that builds upon an idea. He'll lay a foundation, and then he'll say, therefore, since we got that established, we can now conclude or build upon that idea. And you will see one of the most repeated words in all the writings of Paul is the word therefore. It's just, that's what it's there for, she said. No, whenever I see the word therefore, I always say, what is that therefore? There's a reason that there's a therefore. And if you had to study English like I did as a second language, they confuse you even more when you go to school. They call it an associative conjunctive. That's a big word for like little words, like but. But is a disassociative conjunctive, and therefore is an associative conjunctive. I had to learn that. Why? I don't know. It's like the most, you know, useless piece of information. But it does teach me that whenever I see these words in the scripture, I need to recognize that the thought that was said before is being joined to what is coming next. In other words, it's not just random happenstance, you know, mishmash like a quilt patchwork. It's literally has a purpose, and Paul is one of the most experts at, you know, his studying under Gamaliel caused him to be truly a guy that had a command of the scriptures. He had the title Pharisee of Pharisees. Requirement, you must write out the entire book of Isaiah, or it was called the scroll. Jot for tittle, every little mark, everything, and you must memorize. Any of you memorized all 66 chapters of the book of Isaiah lately? I mean, this guy had it down. And I could tell you that he was not just a student of the book of Isaiah, because when you read his writings, he quotes from all over the Old Testament. That was their scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures. And he was able to take those scriptures and point out Jesus to the people that had an ear to hear about the Lord. And so we saw last week, he said he was not ashamed, verse 16, of the gospel, for it was the power of God unto salvation for how many people? For everyone who believes. First to the Jew. Remember, salvation came first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. And then he went on to say, for in this, the gospel, it says, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. Truly, you know, God has made it where the gospel is not exclusive. Everyone is allowed to enter into this good news. And it's not based on works, as we see when he writes to the church at Ephesus. Remember Ephesians chapter 2, Paul says, we are saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. We can't brag. We can't act like we're better than anyone. We're only saved because Jesus paid it all. When he was on the cross at the end, he said, it is what? Finished. And when he declared that, it is finished, he was saying, I have paid all that would be required of the law. I have fulfilled it so that men could be saved. He did it. Now, what do I have to do to receive that gift of salvation? Well, it's like any gift. If someone says, here's a gift for you, and they extend their hand to you to offer it to you, what do you have to do? You have to take it. You have to believe. I mean, what if you don't believe they really give it? I don't believe you're really going to give me that keys to that Mercedes. And you go, but here, it's for you. You know, some of you, if someone did that to you, you'd be going, what's the catch? You know, what do you want? I don't know. Now, let me just share this with you. The Bible says, unless you become as a child, you can't really receive the things of the kingdom of God. Now, that stumbles some older folks. They're like, I don't get that verse. I said, listen, you obviously have never done children's ministry. Because that's how I came into serving the Lord, was working with kids. And if you tell a kid, you reach in your pocket, you got some candies, and you say, hey, I got a candy for you. And you start to put your hand out, okay? And you got them clutched in your hand so you won't drop them. I guarantee before you can get your hand all the way open, what's going to happen? They're going to snatch them. You'll be like, like a cobra striker. Wah, I got it. You know, they do not hesitate to receive a gift. And they don't go, what's the catch? Or how much is this going to cost? Or what's your ulterior motives? They just believe you when you say, I have a gift for you. But when certain people come around the Christian groups and they hear this good news is free. Let me, by the way, the gospel is freely given. The good news is free, but it wasn't free to God. It cost him his very only begotten son. If you ask me to give up my only begotten son, Daniel, the Bible says for a good man, someone might die. You know, maybe take the bullet for a good. But for an evil man, would we do it? I know I would. You say, give up my son for an evil man. No. But God gave up his son. He paid the ultimate price so we could have fellowship with him. And it wasn't free to him. But he now offers it free to us. And to everyone who believes, anyone that wants it, you have to just have enough faith to take it. I mean, it's a gift. And he's going, I want to give you everlasting life. Would you like that? And he doesn't put any strings attached to it. He just says, I offer it to you. The only catch is what? You have to believe. I mean, you really have to believe to actually receive. If I went like this, I got candies in my pocket I want to give you, and the kid goes, I don't believe you. And I do. Well, I can't see them. They're in your pocket. Well, they're here, and I want to give them to you. Now, maybe they don't believe me until I pull my hand out, right? And as soon as I start to do this, and they see, they are the fastest to believe. Man, all they need is a glimpse. Just a little glimpse of that wrapper. What the? I'll take it. And this morning, I want to show you in the book of Romans, chapter 1, that Paul understood this whole concept of the gospel being available to everyone. But he goes and quotes Habakkuk, and he says, it is the righteous man, this righteous man, that this quote he says, verse 17, the end of it, but it is the righteous man that shall live by what? By faith. It's just, the man is, by righteous, we mean right, in right standing with God. To be in right standing with God, you just have to believe him when he says, I want to give you a gift, so that you can receive the gift and accept it. And so Paul's saying, salvation's for everyone. It's the power of God, the gospel is, to all men who believe. But then, as we looked at last week, his quote from Habakkuk says, I mean, he really literally quoted only half that verse, because the verse began with, but the proud man, his heart is not right, what? Within him. This is Habakkuk chapter 2. For those who are listening this week, didn't get to hear last week's study. Habakkuk 2, verse 4 is where Paul is quoting from right here, that the righteous man shall live by faith. But the verse doesn't begin with that line. It ends with that line. And there's that little disassociative conjunctive, but the righteous man. So in contrast to the righteous man living by faith, there's a proud man. A proud man, it says, that heart is not right within him. Whenever we become proud, we don't even see it sometimes. We become blind. It's like spiritual blinders go up. And there can be a lot of things going on. We can be doing things wrong, but we're so proud, we don't see it. And the Bible teaches that God is opposed to the proud. James writes, but he gives grace to the what? To the humble. So I want to be one of the guys that is humble, pleasing in his sight. You know, that is a person that just seeks after him. Because the Bible tells us he'll strongly support us if we do that. And I don't know about you, but anyone want God's strong support? I'm like, Lord, please. Yeah, bring it on. I love it when you support me. Well, here in Romans chapter 2, Paul has just said the righteous man, but the righteous man shall live by faith. Now, what about the unrighteous man? The one that is not in right standing with God. Paul is now going to address that. In verse 18, he says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness, all unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them. For God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power, his divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through that which has been made, so that they are without excuse. For even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God, nor give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, some of you know this verse, they became what? Fools instead. And they exchanged the glory of an incorruptible God for an image in the form of corruptible man and of birds and four-footed creatures and crawling creatures. He said, therefore God gave them over to the lusts of their heart, to impurity, so that their bodies would be dishonored amongst them. For they exchanged the truth of God for a lie. And they went to serve the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Now there's a break here. Your Bible doesn't make it a chapter distinction of a break, but there's actually a break in his writing right here where he says, amen. He says there's an exchange that has happened in the unrighteous person's mind. They have traded in serving the one who created everything for serving what? The creation, the creature. By the way, we don't want to make that mistake. Don't ever serve the creation. Serve the guy who created it, right? I mean, we're not, that's a real step down. If you think about it. Some guys are like, yeah, but Pastor, I got this like piece of wood. We carved it into this little statue. It's got a big belly, and we worship it, and it's our God. And, you know, if you read the Old Testament prophets, they would rebuke you. They'd say, does that statue, they carve a face on it and everything. He says, is it able to speak? It has ears carved on it. Does it hear? You know, it has eyes on it. Does it see? Does it answer? I mean, he says, the prophet, I love this. He says, you fools. From the same piece of wood, you carve an idol that you worship, and then you take the extra chunks of wood, and what do? They used it for firewood, yeah, to keep them warm. And they're like, oh, God, you're such a great God. You have just exchanged this glorious, marvelous creator of all things for a chunk of wood in creation. You know, a piece of a tree or a piece of a rock. Do not trade. Turn with me to Exodus 20, would you? I want to show you. This is, as far as no-nos go, this is a biggie. And Paul is not teaching. Now, you remember, he's writing to a group of believers that in Rome, were Rome all Roman? Were they all Jewish believers over there in Rome, do you think? No. No, so he's got a lot of Gentile believers, and a lot of them don't know the Jewish scriptures at this point in history. They don't know the Ten Commandments. That was a kind of exclusively Jewish club thing. But how many of you, when you were younger, you were raised and you were exposed to the Ten Commandments, maybe up on the wall somewhere or at a church or on the side of a building? You know, where I went to school, a Catholic school, we had them right on the building. Well, in Exodus chapter 20, the very first commandments. What Paul is telling us is really, he's summing up, or in the Jewish way of saying it, he's commenting, in-depth commentary on the Ten Commandments, the very first one. Let me show it to you. He says, then, it says in Exodus 20, verse 1, then God spoke all these words. He said, first command, I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have how many other gods before me? No other gods. Very first command. You don't get to trade him in. You don't trade the creator of everything in for another god. And then the second command. Now, some of you already know these because you had to learn them like I did in school. But he says the second command is you should not make for yourself any idol, any likeness of what is in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the water under the earth. You shall not worship them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. I visit the iniquity of the fathers on the children on the third and fourth generation of those that hate me. But to those who love me, he shows loving kindness to the what generation? The thousandth generation. Thousands generations, he says, to those that love me and keep my commandment. So the first commands are given. You don't have any other gods, and you don't make any idols. When we were in catechism, they made it a little shorter for us to remember. You know, no gods, no other gods, and no idols. You don't trade in the creator for something created. It's just but how many people worship things that are created? Maybe by the hand of another man, maybe the thing that they worship, maybe it's look at that car. Wow. Or that new cell phone, or that new gadget, or that something some other man made. They're all excited, like, this is it, man. And their life revolves. I mean, they literally don't even catch that they're worshiping it. Oh, shit, baby. Oh, shit. Great car. Oh, yeah. It's a car. Someone else made it. It's part of creation. Let's not make the mistake of worshiping the things what have been created in exchange for the one who created it. We're to worship him who created all these things. And now, Paul knew this, but he's got to remind the church at Rome, guys, this is an important thing. You know, the unrighteous, they don't live by faith. And he starts to explain what happens when they don't. Because when they, even though he says in verse 20, back to Romans, I'm sorry, chapter 1, he says, verse 21, even though they knew God, he says they didn't honor him as God, nor did they give thanks, like Tirsa did this morning. We give thanks to the Lord because he's good. And he says, and they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Whenever we don't acknowledge God for who he is, a darkness, a veil comes over our eyes. Oh, we think we're wise. He says, professing to be wise, they become fools instead. You know what's ironic to me is, how many of you in school like science? Anybody here liked science? I love science, by the way. I know, science nerd, math nerd, you know, physics nerd, calculus, I loved all that stuff. And you know, in the earth science class that I had in school, we were taught that the world was 1 million years old. That's how old I am. Because when I went to school, it was 1 million years. How old is it now, Raquel? No, they went into what? How many billions? 4.5 billion. So somehow, it was only 1 million when I was in high school, and it's 4.5 billion today. Because we didn't have enough time to squeeze in all the random acts of nothingness that brought all of this. And so now this is either I am really ancient, or somebody's been changing the tune. And they keep changing the tune because it's part of their professing to be wise. Well, you know, we thought it was this way, but we think maybe now it's this way. And, you know, we carbon dated this fossil to be this old. And I was the kid in school who said, excuse me, how does carbon dating work? was based on an isotope that the decay of an atom and its loss of this one isotope, and it loses this isotope every 10,000 years. One of these isotopes is lost, and so we can count the isotopes in this carbon molecule. And I said, so who was measuring it 1,000 years ago to notice how many were on the molecule so that I could know for certain that it lost one? Because I carbon dated a Bic pen in college. I did. I was like, okay, if this is real, then we need to carbon date. Now, of course, a Bic pen's made from oil, right? I mean, plastic comes from oil, petroleum. And so guess what it did? This Bic pen was like 10,000 years old, according to carbon dating. 10,000 years. Bic must have been just, yahoo, we've been around forever. We're celebrating our 10,000th anniversary, you know? I mean, how foolish was that? But see, sometimes in professing to be wise, men come up with some things that, you know, you just, and you, by the way, you get ridiculed if you stand up in school and say, excuse me, just a proof of concept, let's think this through. Who was measuring the isotope degeneration, you know, 1,000, 2,000? Who followed that molecule for all this time to make sure that it actually lost one of those isotopes? How do we know that rate of decay is accurate? I ask those kind of questions. I got poop hot. You cause too much trouble. You're one of those smart Alex in school. Well, I was one of the smart kids. But I wasn't going to swallow a bunch of baloney just because they said this is true. Professing to be wise, let's shovel some garbage down your throat and tell you that this is how old it is, when that's not what God declared. So I look at these things and I go, why do some men think like this? Well, Paul gave me an insight why they do. He says, because a veil has come over their eyes. They started it off by not acknowledging the Creator. And when they stop acknowledging Him, even though it says His invisible attributes, verse 20, are His eternal power, His divine nature are clearly seen. By what? By what has been made. How many of you, besides me, like the outdoors when it comes to, how many of you feel closer to God when you're outdoors than when you're indoors? Does anyone share that sentiment? When I'm outside and I just am surrounded with His creation, something inside me says, this is church. Okay, I mean, I know some people say, why don't you go for a building? I said, can you beat this wallpaper? I mean, look, we have His handiwork all around us. We just studied Psalm 19 recently, and we saw in the Psalm, the very first verse of Psalm 19 says, the heavens are telling of the glory of God. Their expanse are declaring His handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. You look every night into the stars, and you look at the fantastic array that He has made. One of the young men, Johan, went up from our youth group. He went up to Waimea, and he's a photography buff. And he put his camera on the time-lapse setting for the Milky Way. And it took just like, I don't know, two shots a minute. Just click, click, you know, every minute, two shots through the entire night. The whole video is only like 7 seconds long or something, a minute something. But what is it? You saw it, Dylan, right? It's 7 seconds. It's all compressed into one of those shots, and you see all the stars in the Milky Way going and turning, and it's just like, oh, man, that is so cool. I mean, I don't know about you guys. Anyone like to watch those time-lapse photography things where the flower's in the ground, and it goes, and it pops out, and then it grows? And for us that are impatient, time-lapse photography is great. I mean, we appreciate God's handiwork even more, because we see it faster, you know. But the farmer sees it all day long because he's out in the field and he watches his plants, and he has an appreciation that started as a seed and it grew into this crop. And you see things that, you know, the farmers understand they don't make the crop grow. They only put the seed in the ground and they pray for the water to water the seed, and they know who it is who causes the growth. The Creator brings the life. And when we stop acknowledging that, when we stop seeing, and I think really it's probably easier for people that live in cities, concrete jungles I call them, where they don't see the marvel of creation around them. They're just hemmed in by sidewalks and pukey fumes of cars, and it's maybe harder for them to see His invisible attributes all around. You got to get them out, you know? Take them on one of those nature walks and say, look around at this. Who made this? It's because they're used to looking at buildings that men have made, and they start to make that the frame of reference, and they become, well, Paul's going to say it, they exchange this glory of an incorruptible God for something that is not glorious at all. And they serve the creature rather than the Creator. Now, for this reason, Paul says there's a digression that begins. Whenever you trade God for another God, or you begin to worship a false idol, you may not even recognize it, but there will become a change in your personality. There'll become a change in your outlook. There'll become a change in the whole way you perceive life. And you'll change what you live for. You know, when you recognize God as your Creator, it gives you purpose. It gives you the right reason to live. Man, I'm living to please Him. We just sang it this morning. He has shown thee, O man, what is good. What does the Lord require of us? Three things. Do justly. Love what? Mercy. And walk what? Humbly with our God. He's shown us what to do. Do justly means do what is just, what is right in the sight of God. And love mercy. Man, there's nothing more beautiful than a person that has a heart of mercy. You know, I love to be around those merciful people. They just, when you're around them, you're just like, oh, there's a sweetness for your soul. It just encourages you. And the last one that He's shown us that we have to do, when men say, I don't know what God wants me to do, you tell them, He already told us. Micah 6:8. To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk what? Humbly with our God. But if you don't want to do those things, and you don't want to acknowledge the Creator, and you want to serve the creation, He says this is what will happen. God will then, for this reason, verse 26 says, He'll give them over to degrading passions. The women will exchange the natural function for that which is unnatural. The men will in the same way abandon the natural function of the women and burn in their desire toward one another. Men with men, He says, committing indecent acts and receiving in their own persons the due penalty of their error. And just, He says in verse 28, as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind, to do those things which are not proper, being filled with all unrighteousness and wickedness and greed, evil, full of envy, murder and strife and deceit and malice. He says they're gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, arrogant, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, without understanding. They're untrustworthy. They're unloving, unmerciful. Now, we just said He's shown us we're to love mercy. But the ones who don't follow Him, isn't it interesting? He says they become unmerciful, without mercy. And although they know the ordinance of God, that those that practice such things are worthy of death, they not only do the same. This is important for you to pay attention. You might want to highlight the last part of this verse. They don't only do these things, but it says they give hearty approval to those that practice them. They're never going to pat you on the back if you're not joining their club. But if you happen to sin in the manner that they sin, you're unmerciful, you're boastful, you're evil, you're disobedient to your parents, they'll say, good on you. Yeah, I'm the same way. You know, it's the old misery loves company thing. Because if you live like this, full of envy, full of gossip, full of strife, slandering people. Do you really have a joyful life? I submit to you, you're miserable. You really are. And your focus of your life has changed. No longer is your focus one with that broad perspective of, I have a heavenly creator that loves me, that cares so much for me that he would send his son to grant me everlasting life. You don't get to bask in that knowledge. In fact, you say, I don't believe he's there. I'm going to worship this stick or that rock or whatever other thing that they choose to make their God. Their automobile collection, their postage stamp collection. What people make gods out of weird things in this culture. And the problem is they trade him in. And when you trade in God for any other God, God goes, all right, I'll let you do it, but I'm going to give you over to what's called a depraved mind. Depraved means deprived of his being there. It's like a removal of that part that is inwardly wired in all of us, that we know there's someone greater out there. We don't actually have to prove God's existence. He said, I already made it apparent to all men, to all that is made. They can just look around and see somebody out there is bigger than them. I mean, you just look at the marvelousness of all of creation. You look at how complex even the little ecosystems are between certain plants and the bees. They have to have a certain bee that pollinates a certain plant in a certain region. Without it, the two can't you don't have one, the other dies. In South America, they have a stingerless bee about a half an inch long. You guys probably like them better than the kinds with stingers. But those little stingerless bees are the only natural pollinators of the orchid that produces vanilla beans. In Hawaii, we grow vanilla. I have vanilla growing in my house. But for years, it grew and grew. It never made one stinking vanilla bean. I got some flowers. I looked at the flowers. What's wrong with this plant? It's never going to give me a bean. Then I had to study up and find out you got to play bee. Open up flower. Poke the little part from the one part into the other part. And make the pollen go in the right spot. And if you get it right, and by the way, it's like a little teeny hole with like toothpick size. You get it right. 9 months from then, it's like waiting for a baby. You get this bean, a vanilla bean. Last year we got 481. It was, by the way, the window to pollinate, they say it's all morning long. That's baloney. It's 1 hour. In Hawaii. I just from experience, there's about a 1 hour sweet spot where the flower is open enough and the pollen is easily transferred and you get it to work. So I look at that and think, God, you are amazing, because without the regions that don't have that little bee, they don't get vanilla beans. They just don't. Until this generation where we started, fiddling with actually hand pollinating, doing it. We're playing bee. I wish they imported mongooses. That was a brilliant move. They should import the stingerless bee. They don't sting you, and they would pollinate a whole bunch of flowers. If any of you want to take up a new hobby, do that stingerless beekeeping, okay? And bless our islands. We'd have an explosion on the flower side. But The marvelousness to me of God's creation, just in that very act that he made that bee to do that job, that's the only, that bee lives off the pollen of just that orchid. Is it random chance after millions and billions of, no, I'm sorry, multi-billions of years now that the bee figured it out to go to that? The problem with professing to be wise and believing in this evolution theory is that there's too many gaps. Because evolution will tell you the plant came at this time, later on came the bee, and you find out that plant wouldn't survive without that bee. So what's the Bible declare? God made them all on how many days? I mean, did he spread it out over billions of years? No. Because he knew it wouldn't work. There are so many codependencies, these remarkable relationships that we have between different creatures, that they would all have to be there at the same time. And if I read the account in Genesis, God goes, oh, today I'm going to make all the animals. Poof. You know, before that, all the plants, poof, done. All the fish of the sea, done. I mean, he doesn't wait to put them in after millions and billions of years, because you wouldn't, the thing that lives off the other thing wouldn't be around and they would never evolve. That's professing to be wise. Now share that in school today and you'll get poo-pawed by some of the, quote, higher learning teachers. Challenge them on it, like crazy me, and you got to be careful. I mean, I had one teacher when I failed me. I said, look, you're not failing me. I'll take you on right in front of everybody. I'll debate you right now. You're operating on flawed information. And I submit to you that it's flawed. And you know what's interesting to me is so wise they are in one discipline. They only study one discipline. And they don't even understand that the disciplines of math and science and physics, they all overlap. The knowledge is shared. It's not, well, we got the exclusive thing. My wife had to study years and years of chemistry to become a medical technologist. When you study lots and lots of chemistry, do you have to use math? Yes. You sure do. Because you mess up one math calculation, you can kill somebody. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're doing that laboratory stuff and people's lives depend on it, you better be good at both disciplines. My wife didn't like the math part. Not everyone does. But you can't dismiss the other's discipline just because you don't like it. And you can't say, well, I have this understanding and that's what stands, and ignore how about all those other things that are out there that we can learn. See, I don't believe we should do that. I think when you acknowledge the Creator, it opens your mind up to see all of His creation. And that's what He wants for you. He wants your mind to, I mean, He doesn't mind blowing your mind because He's bigger than you. And if you've got a problem that we have a God that's bigger than us, that knows more than us, well, I'm sorry, but maybe you're just too proud. And maybe that verse from Habakkuk's for you, that your soul is not right within you. You need to humble yourself. Because it's okay to have a God bigger than us. Who wants to make a God I carved and is smaller than me? I made that. I'm going to worship it now as God. Answer me, O God. You'd be looking at me like going, whoo, cuckoo, cuckoo. You know, you're crazy. Worshiping the thing you just made. Let's don't make that mistake. The one that is not righteous has made that mistake, though. And a veil comes over their eyes. And then they begin to do things that are not right. You know, some people always want me to teach Romans chapter 1, the last part about people. Oh, hit the part about the sexual orientation. Did you see the women exchange the natural function of the men? And they exchanged something before that exchange. They exchanged the Creator for His creation. Because if you serve the Creator, how many of you can tell me the very first commandment in the Bible? Now, I just read you the Ten Commandments, but they're not the first. They wouldn't come along till about 1400 BC when with Moses, right? They're not the first. God spoke before that. Go to the book of Genesis. God makes Adam. Sees it's not good for Adam to be alone, so He puts him to sleep, takes a rib, makes woman taken from man, presents her, Eve, to Adam, and puts him in a garden naked. Says they were not ashamed because there wasn't sin. Now, your perfect man with the perfect gal made just for you. Naked in a garden. Made by God. Paradise, it was called. No thorns, no thistles, right? Anyone think this is a bad scene? You're like, wow, bummer. I mean, I'm envious. I'm like, dude, you got it. And by the way, the first command that God gave to mankind, those of you know what it is, be fruitful and what? Multiply. Okay, Adam, you're in a garden, naked with a perfect woman. God is uptight about sex, isn't He? No. I mean, I'm not here to give you the birds and bees study, but, you know, how do you be fruitful and multiply if you have the perfect man with the perfect woman naked in a garden? You got to do something. And the Lord gave that as the very first command, be fruitful and multiply. Now, whenever you don't acknowledge him as the creator, you're not going to follow his ways. He's the creator of life. He was giving to them an edict. I made you alive. Now you're going to make life. You're going to pass life. This is command, his command, to bring life. Jesus said it. I came to give you life and to give it to you what? More abundantly. But when you don't acknowledge the creator, you don't acknowledge him even in his very first commandment. So you trade in his prototype for relationship and you replace it with your own. One that does not make life, by the way. I can do this since we have the video. My nonna, when I was growing up, she would use hand gestures to teach us this thing about the birds and the bees, so to speak, the guys and the girls. She would say, this is the guy, this is the girl. I'm going to get a lot of heat for this, but I don't care. She would say to me, God made this to make life. She would say, this, one girl, che faccia. In Italian, that means, what does it make? Or this, che faccia. She would, now, you have to understand how my nonna would say it. When she say, che faccia, like, what does it make? She would ask me. I say, nothing. It can't. This can't make anything. It doesn't make. But God's edict was to man with his wife. He did not make Adam and Steve. He made Adam and Eve. And some people are like, man, you're really uptight about this, man. You're like also, you know, you're old school. Dude, this is how it was from the beginning. And the new school, que faccia. That's all I can tell you. What does it make? Nothing. And when people say, preach against that, no. Because see, the reason that they're doing that is because of something that came before. They have now, they see, if you ever have someone that you love that has adopted these lifestyles, you could talk to them all day long about their sexual orientation. You're not going to get anywhere. Because it's not a matter of their orientation down here. It's a matter, it's not on this horizontal plane, the orientation between others. That's the problem. Where's the real problem lie? In what we call the vertical relationship that we have between us down here and our Creator. And they have already traded in his ways to something down there. Instead of worshiping him up there so that they have this correct, they worship something down here, and now everything is off. This is why they get into this place. So don't waste your time talking about this. Talk about how are you with your Creator? Have you exchanged him for anything down here? You really care about that friend of yours that's gay? Talk to them in love about a God who loves us. And who loves them and died for, sent his son for them, their sin just as much as ours. You're going to see, we're going to go farther in Romans. How many of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God? All. Let's go to the root. The root is this vertical. And then if you get this aligned, guess what happens to all the stuff down here? See, this, it levels out when this is on the right compass. Okay, and we need to take them to this so that we can get the rest of this taken care of. You cannot adjust this when they're already on the... Does that make sense? This is what Paul's describing. And this, I didn't learn this right away. I tried to adjust other people's this to great demise. Just learn from my mistake. It doesn't work, okay? Anyone else could give an amen to that?
Amen.
Help them in this. Help them go back to the very first of the Ten Commandments. Worship only Him. He's a jealous God. Don't make any other idols. Don't worship anything down here. Worship the Creator for who He is. Your mind will open up. Your understanding will become clearer than ever. You'll be able to actually connect other disciplines together. And it's only because He created all the disciplines that to Him, it's all just part of His marvelous ability. He didn't go, well, I'm only good at physics today. Tomorrow I'm doing calculus. No. He did them all at the same time. Like, the more I study those higher, quote, learnings, the more that at first it's just confusion. I mean, there's so much information. But when you finally start to digest, all of a sudden you start going, wait a minute, that's basically the principle I learned over in my physics class, but just expressed in a mathematical expression. And when I would explain that to the physics teacher, they're like, I did terrible in math. I'm like, but dude, I'm telling you, we learned this in calculus. You're saying it, you just use different, you use a different lingo, because by the way, math nerds have their own lingo. Just like computer nerds, just like physics nerds, just like those medical people. You gotta learn another language to be medical. I mean, Latin is like, no excuse, learn Latin or don't even bother. I mean, they talk in Latin, even vets. I got a couple of them around here. The Latin is like, just like their second language. Everything's described with these different, and that hinders people from sharing ideas. If I'm speaking one language, you're speaking another language, but we're trying to describe the same thing, but we don't know each other's language, guess what? We're going, I don't get you. You're weird. I know, because I grew up speaking a different language. And believe me, when you talk to someone in a different language and they don't know that language and they look at you like deer in headlights, huh? What'd you say? And you're like, I'm just saying. Like, you could just be saying, hey, do you want to go over there and get a drink at the fountain? No, what did you say? Did you swear at me? I didn't swear at you. Did you want to go and play basketball? You say whatever in a different language. If they don't know your language, they think you're weird. Why is it we won't take enough time to, when we took that cruise with my kids, I said, kids, you better learn to say thank you in a different person's language. We had on the cruise ship, they had this room steward from the Philippines. They had a waiter from Thailand. They had, from different places in the world. These people are all working on these ships. And if you just say thank you in their language, do you know how much it means to them? I mean, they're just like, oh. I tell Daniel, say thank you to, because he has gone to the Philippines in Tagalog, And he would, salamat po, because that's for the, he's younger, he's saying to the adult, respectfully. And the guy was like, pouring his water, like, every time he came around Daniel, I noticed he was all, like, good kid, Just to say, why won't we just take a little time to bridge the gap? Americans are pompous. There's no doubt about it. We're like, everybody, you speak our language or you're stupid. Then you meet them and you find out they speak five other languages. Who's really stupid? Let's don't be stupid spiritually either. You might speak a bunch of languages in the spirit. You might know things. But you got to help the ones who don't. Help them get to this right relationship. Go back to the basics. Say, hey, let's don't miss out on the big picture. We got to worship the guy who created us. And if you have someone whose orientation is off in the sexual area, try to get them oriented back towards the Lord. And the Bible says faith comes by what?
Hearing.
Hearing by the word of God. Let him hear about God. What he's doing in your life. Let him know that he's still there. The Creator is still active. He's still around. Because you'll encourage your faith more by that than any other thing you can do. Arguing with them about their sexual orientation, that's not going to bring them to God. Just sharing with them how much you appreciate his love toward you. the gift he gave for you, and how that gift's for everyone. We're not,
hey, I got the gift, you don't get to have it. You got the wrong orientation. No,
we're just going to get you in the right orientation. The gift is for how many that believe? All. Let's remember that this week. Because we could be used powerfully to see lots of people reconnected to the man they need to be, our Creator, our Heavenly Father. Let's pray. Father, thanks so much for this passage, what you gave through the Apostle Paul to the church at Rome, Lord, that we can glean truth from this. We can see truths that we can use in our lives, we can live out. Help us, Lord. Help us be people that just acknowledge you in all our ways. And Lord, let it be a light to those that don't have that knowledge, Lord, that we can help lead them into your light. And I pray that, Lord, I have some that I care dearly for, that they have the wrong orientation, Lord, but they don't know. Some that have chosen to go the wrong way, Lord, I would pray that you would just, even as you went after that one wandering sheep, Lord, you would go after them. And you would bring back those loved ones that we have that, and bring them back into following you with their whole heart. And I ask that, Father, in Jesus, your precious Son's name. Anyone that agreed with me said?
Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with me? Let's sing a closing song and send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.